Okay, hi, welcome to Audio Man Matters. Turn your engagement up to 11. Yay, I'm back. Okay, give me a hey. I can hear you. If we can, if you can hear me through your computer speakers, if you've joined via VoIP, which is great, and give me a I can hear you. Yay, if you've joined from the phone. Thanks, Helene. Kippy, great. Ryan, good. You can hear us. Fantastic. All right. Wonderful. We're ready to get started. Hey, thanks for joining me today. We are here to talk about audio matters. And, you know, bloopers happen. Things happen when you've got technology involved. Even if it's like something simple as a phone, stuff happens. And so you've got to figure out how to manage it, right? And we're going to talk about that today, as well as things to keep in mind and considerations when you're selecting the right audio for your needs. So my name is Dana Sednick, and I am with Live Online Learning Solutions. I'm here with Meeting One today to talk about all of these different things. And let me give you a sense of how we're going to work together today. I love that we've got some good chats happening over on the right, and we've got folks who are sharing with us some of their audio bloopers that they've experienced. And your experience thus far, I'd love you to share a little bit about where you're at when it comes to live online sessions, whether it's meetings, whether it's training, whether it's marketing and webinars, any kind of insight into your experience, and whether it's with Adobe Connect or not, just get a good sense of who's on the call here. I'll share the results here in a moment. So as we move today through our presentation, we want to interact with you in really two-plus big ways. One, if you have questions, there's a Q&A pod over here the left, and we will have our team sort through some of those things. You'll get to see your answers come through, and they can pop them over to me. We'll answer them throughout our call today. So don't wait till the end to give us some questions as we keep going. And then over on the right, we've got this general chat, which is excellent, and that really helps a lot with sharing and continuing the conversation and adding any color or experience that you have. Because I know there are about 44% of you who've been hosting sessions for a while. So you might have some good tips and tricks to share. So let me broadcast these results on kind of where we're at in terms of experience that we have on the call. And I love it. It's like a bell curve. So we've got a lot of experience here, 44% of you who said that you've been hosting sessions for a while. I challenge you to share what you know in that general chat as we continue on. So, all right, excellent. Yes, logging in and out and coming back in. Sometimes that happens in terms of your bandwidth or the type of browser that you're using, et cetera, and you can always jump in and ask for assistance. Our folks here at Meeting One will help you and coordinate so that that doesn't keep happening. Okay, so let's talk about engagement and turning it up to 11. Here we go. So what do we mean by turning our engagement up to 11? I thought that things only go up to 10, yeah? Well, let's watch a quick video to set our context so we get a shared understanding of what we mean by turning it up to 11. So for any of you who have ever seen the spoof rock documentary called Spinal Tap, it's about this band called Spinal Tap, and in this quick video, we will watch Nigel Tufnell. He's going to explain how his band's amplifiers go up to 11 for when you need that extra push over the cliff. And so before I share this video, I'm going to say a couple things. You can hashtag your reaction in that chat pod right below the video. And for those who are on the phone with us, only on the phone, make sure that at the top of your screen, in that red banner there, there is a little audio button, and that audio button should be green. It should be able to, you should be able to hear the video through your computer speakers. You will not be hearing it over the phone. So let's do this. Let's watch Nigel explain explain what it means to turn it up to 11.
This is a top to a, you know, what we use on stage, but it's very, very special because if you can see,
yeah,
the numbers all go to 11. Look, right across the board. 11, oh, 11,
and most of
11,
and then amps go up to 10.
Exactly.
Does that mean it's louder? Is it any louder?
Well, it's one louder, isn't it? It's not 10. You see, most blokes are going to be playing at 10. You're on 10 here, all the way up, all the way up,
yeah,
all the way up. You're on 10 on your guitar. Where can you go from there? Where?
I don't know.
Nowhere, exactly. What we do is if we need that extra push over the cliff, you know what we do?
Put it up to 11.
11, exactly. One louder.
Why don't you just make 10 louder and make 10 be the top number and make that a little louder?
These go to 11.
These go to 11. So if you need an extra push over the cliff, if you've got to get to better than to 10, we're going to go to 11. So we're going to push it over the cliff, right? Exactly, Doreen. Hilarious. So you can see more of Spinal Tap. We found this video on YouTube. It's available there. So very, very good. Okay, so let's start talking about what it means to turn it up to 11 when it comes to what you're doing live online. So whether you use Adobe Connect, whether you're a Meeting One customer, whether you're a prospective customer, you've got goals. You want to turn something up in order to do something. At least I think you do. So I'd love to hear from you. We have a new chat pod here that's a little bit about help me fill in the answers so I can get a shared understanding of what it is that you want to accomplish out of this. So complete the sentence for me, and Amy, thanks for jumping in there and getting our conversation started. So I want to blank so that I can blank. And if you want to cheat, you can fill in one of those blanks with turn it up to 11 if you'd like. So here we go. We've got multiple attendees typing. John, I agree with you. Best fake documentary ever. Although I know that there's some additional new fake documentaries happening on Netflix, right, that you can jump in here. So Doreen says, I want to keep participants engaged so that I'm not talking to crickets. Oh, my gosh. Yes, right? Those crickets, they happen to be really good listeners, but you can never really tell how they're really feeling about things. I love it. Okay, so Donna says, I want to get a handle on the audio challenges so that I can improve our center's webinar experiences. Totally, totally. Amy wants to be confident in troubleshooting audio issues so that I can turn it up to 11. I love it. Thank you. Latanya says, learn basics, tips, and tricks so that I can be the best virtual trainer that I can be. Keep my participants engaged. Fabulous. We've got some dittos here about Karen's. Learn how to be more combined audio options so that I can allow phone interaction yet show multimedia with minimal confusion to learners. Very good, Karen. So you might need a little bit of a blended type of audio solution, kind of like what we have today going on, a couple of folks on the phone, audio, a handful, actually more of you, of the 100 or so folks here who are on the VoIP. So they're hearing everything through our computer speakers. All right, I'm going to give Nicholas and Patrick the last moment here to share with us, and then we'll continue on to really talk about what we're going to talk about today. Because I love Sheila's point here that she put in the general chat. I feel like I know everything about what I actually know about. And sometimes when we think about and adjust our perspective, sometimes we can come up with these tips that will take us even further, right? Take us beyond the cliff and the extra push over the cliff. So let's talk about those. All right, Dawn and Shelby, thanks so much for giving us a better perspective on what you're looking for today. So we're going to talk about four things, and these four things also happen to be audio best practices. So we're going to run through this audio best practice component here and get a good sense of what that looks like. Okay, so Very good. It looks like Joel has a question about why didn't I have the option to join on my computer when I signed into the audio meeting. Fabulous. If you could, Brittany and Brittany, our friends over at Meeting One, if you could help answer Joel's question, that would be fantastic. All right. So here we go. We are going to talk about the four best practices, and then we're going to learn a little bit about the audio options that you can control as a host or a presenter or a meeting guide or facilitator, whatever you want to call it, however you represent yourself to your attendees. So here we go. Choose the simplest solution. We're going to talk about providing multiple chat pods and the benefit of that that helps you turn your engagement up to 11. We'll actually experience what it's like to have no audio, so silence is okay. We'll talk about that. And then, of course, my favorite, which is all about owning the mute button. Yes, Nick, I love it. It's all about control while keeping interactivity on. That is, you basically summed it up, Nick. Thanks so much for summing everything up and putting it all into a nice, concise sentence, because it is. It's about owning the control and making it really simple for your attendees. So let's talk about that simplicity. When we think about choosing the simplest audio solution, it's something we want to think about ahead of time before we start to set up the session, so that we can eliminate parameters, eliminate distractions, and we'll talk about that here. So why does audio matter? When we think about engagement, let's talk a little bit of considerations about why audio matters. So when it comes to audio and having the right settings, you can automatically interrupt and eliminate some of those disruptions that happen. I love it in the bloopers, in the bloopers poll that we did in the beginning, the disruptions like babies crying, people having offline conversations that are actually online, all those different things, and that stuff happens. But when you take ownership of your audio and set it up so that some of those preventions are in place automatically, it can help eliminate disruptions. So for example, if you're doing a lot of information sharing, just like we are here on our webinar, we have set our audio options to be on mute so that all attendees who come into our program, into our room, are automatically muted. That way we're not getting beeps and we're not getting background noises and we're not relying on our audience to mute themselves. In fact, we've taken ownership and control over it. So you can set and use your audio settings to prevent disruptions instead of having to react to them, right? So that you can eliminate them throughout your sessions here. Okay, great. So another way that you can use audio is to align your experience with the purpose of your meeting. So I talked about a little bit about experience and the types of things that you do in meetings. So another purpose that you might have is having a small group doing some working things. You might have to work on things together, and it's really important that you're hearing individuals talk, right? Because they might have ideas that will add to the work experience or output that you're doing. And so when you think about controlling your audio options, you can make sure that the attendees' experience actually aligns with the purpose of your programs. And we'll talk more about the nuances of that here today. Yeah, on the high-density display in the scale, yeah, it doesn't scale and is unreadable. Interesting. Thank you for that feedback. I'm gonna have to ask one of my colleagues to pop this open in a Adobe Connect mobile. So, Russ, thanks for that feedback. Okay, so, you know, there's this really interesting thing about online meetings, especially when they're delivered at scale, meaning that you're having more people in a room or a virtual room than you might be able to fit in like a normal conference room or around a working table. Some people use Adobe Connect and web conferencing sessions to do things like working sessions where you have a small group of people. However, some people also use this with big, big, large groups, right? Like 250 people at a time. And so when you think about setting and utilizing all of your audio sessions, you want to think about how you engage your attendees in two different ways. How do you engage attendees in a one, meaning one-on-one. So how might I engage Shelby or Alicia or anybody else who is on the call one-to-one, right? And so if we needed to have a conversation, it might be really important that they're on the phone and not over VoIP and muted, for example, right? Versus the many. So the many is about collaborative conversations at scale. We just experienced this today. We had a chance to be able to share with each other how and what you wanted to do in order to turn your engagement up. And we got to watch a video and react to it together. And we've got these sidebar conversations that are happening. So when you think about engagement and using the right type of audio settings, you want to think about in the experience, how are you or how do you need to engage with people one-on-one or the ones, and how can you engage with people in the many? So at scale through dialogue where many people can react and participate all at once. So managing that kind of need is all aligned to the purpose of what you're trying to do in your sessions. So let's talk about trade-offs. When we think about all the different audio settings and the things that you can do with audio, there's a lot of trade-offs that you want to consider. So one of them happens to be cost. When you think about having people on audio, most providers actually charge you by the minute. So when you log in onto the phone, you're getting charged by the minute times the number of attendees who are there. And some don't charge you for attendees who are on VoIP or just listening over. It is either free or less expensive, depending on the audio provider and the solution that you have. So one of the trade-offs that you have is cost when selecting the audio that you need. Another is quality. So for folks who are participating via VoIP or who have participated in VoIP-only types of conversations where you're trying to participate with people one-on-one and hear their voices, if they don't have great bandwidth, you might have a quality reduction issue where you might not understand them or they might turn into a robot. I don't know if anybody's ever heard the VoIP robot participants, but that can happen too. So it depends a little bit on your audience's bandwidth capability, and we'll talk more about those considerations. The other thing is fidelity. So again, just that clearness or crispness of the things that you need to be able to hear with one another, which can really come into play when you've got an international audience who have English as a second language. You need to really hear them to understand them. And sometimes that trade-off can happen when you think about cost over fidelity, over quality, over complexity. The other thing is, of course, complexity. When you think about, okay, so who am I having on the call? Or is it a big, large group who is international and some people aren't allowed to join by VoIP? And I've got a bunch of other people in our Texas office, for example, who are going to be joining in a conference room. And then I've got all of my mobile home workers who are working from their house. And then I've got, you know, on and on and on and on. There's this complexity of thinking about your audience and where they are and what they have and what they need in order to join fully or participate fully in your programs. So some of these are really all about trade-offs. And, you know, another one, for some folks, security is important. It's really important to have a secure line. And so using a dedicated audio with no VoIP capability might be something that is more preferred, even though it might cost more, right? So some of these are trade-offs that you want to continue to think about. The last trade-off, and probably the most important trade-off in my mind, is all about ease of use. So ease of use for you as the host to be able to manage all of the people who are on and all of the different ways and the ways that they show up. So how easy can you make it for yourself, and how easy can you make it for your audience? So if you have a bunch of new folks and newbies who've never been on a web conferencing training or meeting or event, you might want to think about how you can make it really easy to have them join, right? So how might you clear the path and eliminate all of these choices that they don't even understand so that they can just get on and get started and dive into whatever it is that your purpose is, right? So focused and aligned on the purpose. Yeah, totally. Shelby, I love it. And the fewer barriers for participants, the better. I always like to hashtag clear the path. Right? So what's the path to get us to where we need? Clear it out. Eliminate all of those bumpy roads and all of those things. So other trade-offs that you might consider, please share in that general chat if there's any other trade-offs that you think about when you're selecting audio, especially those folks who have been doing this for a long time and are here to talk about turning things up to the to 11. So any other trade-offs or things that you think about when you're selecting the right audio for your needs? Shelby, thanks for jumping in. And others, Alicia, wonderful. Other trade-offs that that you might need to consider as you select the right audio. Multiple attendees. Okay, yeah, totally. The ability to control others' audio. Again, it goes back to what Nicholas said earlier. It's all about the ability to control everything else and see who's on the call, see who's who is creating some of those disruptions so that not only can you prevent them in the front end when you set up a meeting, but you can also react to them in ways that are proactive so that you have or keep control of it. I think one of the things that gets in the way of audio a lot is that we rely a lot on the participants to, like, mute their phones. And in the middle of our sessions, we're like, okay, can everybody please mute your phones? And then the one person who's causing the disruption, like, doesn't mute their phone, and it starts to get annoying, and then everybody's even more annoyed, and now we're off on a tangent talking about something that doesn't keep us moving forward with whatever objective that we have. So when you're thinking about the audio needs that you have, the ability to mute somebody's line and see who it is that is causing the disruption is fantastic and critical. So Meeting One actually has an offering that integrates your phone audio with your Adobe Connect room and provides an additional window that is called Click and Meet that allows you to be able to do so many cool things on the control side of just the audio portion, muting all attendees, muting some attendees, adjusting around audio. It's fantastic and also really critical because then I'll know, right, that it's Anne who has her dogs barking, and I don't have to stop and call out Anne. I can just mute it, right? We don't even need to talk about it. We can just continue on. So very good. Natalia, yes, the slides. We actually will have a handout and a recording after this call that will talk you through all of these things. Fantastic. Very good. Thanks so much both for sharing some of those additional issues and responding our experts who are on the call about considerations. Okay, so bottom line, when you think about it, when you choose audio at the front end, find the simplest solution for your needs. So you've got to assess what it is that you're trying to accomplish so that you can actually kind of clear the path and shorten the amount of exposure or things or choices that both you as a host and attendees have to work around. So let's talk about this. Let's talk about this whole concept of, like, too many choices. So I'm just going to flip here, and in this video, we're going to watch, this is a Discovery News session, and it's all about too many choices and what happens when the brain science of how we get paralyzed by all the decisions that come our way during the day. And you can find this on the Discovery News YouTube channel. And so while we watch this video, please share in the chat your experience with analysis paralysis and a shortcut or regular choice that you use to eliminate choices in your life. And that'll make a little bit more sense when we watch this video. So let's watch this video from D News about choices and how that starts to create some issues in our life. Okay, here we go.
D News, thanks for tuning in. 25 years ago, the average supermarket had 9,000 products. Today, there might be 40,000, but we only need about 150 on average to fulfill our shopping needs. If you're like me, hearing I have to pick 150 out of 40,000 different things, that just causes me anxiety. When confronted with the sheer number of options, some people become paralyzed. The neurons in our brain can't really tell the difference between a small decision and a big one. We still expend energy to make that choice. But why are decisions so hard? Being the decider is hard, and it fatigues the brain. Even when we feel positively about our choices, decisions give us anxiety. The anxiety stems from the conflict of making the decision rather than what they can win from making the right one. In the Steve Jobs biography, it was described that his house was stark and empty, and that it took him months or years to pick, like, a couch to buy. Which sounds a lot like decision paralysis, also called analysis paralysis. The anxiety causes people to overanalyze a decision because there are too many options, and to escape the anxiety, they simply avoid the decision altogether. One shortcut in decision fatigue is to just have a regular choice. Always get the club sandwich, for example, or grab the black turtleneck every day, and it will cut back on your decision fatigue, freeing up mental power for more decisions later.
Mental power for more decisions later. I love it. I think it's hilarious and also really cool where people make the decision that they're going to wear, like, the same thing, right? Like, they open their closet, it's exactly the same thing, so they don't have to make those choices so that they can focus on other more important choices in their life. So, yeah, hilarious. Experience with analysis paralysis. Goodness, Shelby. 3 months to decide which coffee tumbler to buy you for your birthday. Totally. Especially for us who are coffee snobs, it can be paralyzing to find the most perfect gift. Or those who are on the hunt for the gift must be perfect. So Sheila says, considering everyone's experience, auto choices, whether or not to show up, how to set up layouts. Yeah, yeah, for sure. Like, whether or not to show videos, all those things. Those are, like, so many choices, right, in terms of, okay, I've got to run this session. What? How am I going to set up my audio? How am I going to, am I going to run some video? Am I going to do some layouts? What does that really look like in terms of what I'm doing? And we'll actually do this together here in a few minutes about trying it out and thinking about ahead of time, working it out based on what your purpose is so that you can have a better sense of what kind of audio it is that you need based on what you're trying to achieve. So we'll do that together here in a moment. So type of mic and video camera and all of these things. Yeah, totally. There's lots of decisions, especially when it comes to Adobe Connect, because there's a lot of really cool things that you can do. Again, for just to reiterate, right, choosing the simplest solution is always the most preferred. So how can you clear the path to get yourself up and running and having a really great session based on the objectives without all of the distractions or decisions of things? Of course, for folks who are just starting on this journey of live online delivery, you know, one of the things I recommend is start small, right? Webcam and a SharePod and a chat pod. And then as you start to get your sea legs and start to get more confident, then you can add more things. Same goes for audio, right? Like, oftentimes the default is not the simplest solution that we have. So you may want to look at your default settings and see what kind of things you can remove to clear the path and have a more simple solution for your audio. So there we go. Yeah, very good. Thanks so much for sharing shortcuts or regular choices here on what you can do to think about and eliminate some of those distractions. Yes, totally, Tracy. I agree with the KISS methodology. All right, so audio matters. Let's talk about the three types of audio options. And typically, these are audio options that are available on most web platforms. But it's also specific to Connect that we'll talk about mostly, since we're on Connect and we're here through Meeting One. And at Live Online Learning Solutions, my favorite out of all of the apples-to-apples comparisons in terms of web conferences. So we're going to go through three types of audio selections that you have. So the first of the three is VoIP only. And then we're going to talk about phone only, and then we're going to talk about that blend. I know there's some good side conversation about blending, just like we are today, phone and VoIP. So let's talk about VoIP only and some of the considerations that you should think about in selecting this audio based on your needs. So VoIP only means computer speakers to listen, microphone to talk, or no microphone like we have it set up today. I think that VoIP is a really good solution when you've got a large group. They don't need to necessarily be all be on the phone. And likely when you've got a large group, there's a lot of information that you're sharing, and you're not getting a lot of that kind of one-on-one back and forth. You might be looking for that one, that many-to-many type of back and forth conversation. And cost might be a factor for you. If you've got to get something out and you have a very low budget, a great way to be able to do this is to just turn on VoIP only. International audience, you know, there are international folks who actually only prefer to use and are used to using VoIP to be able to use it. And yes, Alicia or Amy, the bandwidth can be an issue for folks who are joining. Bandwidth is always an issue. And some of those preventions that you can use when you're delivering things is to ask your audience ahead of time to ensure that they have a good bandwidth connection. Either they're hardwired in as a best practice or they have like super great Wi-Fi. If they don't, then you may want to consider a different option, meaning a VoIP and phone option, so that people who don't have great bandwidth, maybe you want to just do phone only, so that you'll get some good fidelity against both the audio and the visual or whatever they're seeing. So very, very good. Thanks so much for continuing and sharing your expertise here. So let's talk about the next one, which is phone only. If you've got that bandwidth issue, maybe this is the consideration and the one that you want to go with. So you turn off the VoIP, you mute all of those things, and you only set up the phone. This is a really great option if you've got a small working group and that one-to-one conversation is really important. You need to hear from individual or individuals who are on the call, and you need to understand clearly what they are saying. So call quality is really important to you. Security is a really important issue to you. You may want to simplify your settings and only turn on over the phone. We're going to join the web portion, and then you're going to call over the phone. I'm just going to turn off VoIP as an option. So that helps simplify and clear the path for folks. And then there's a third option. This third option means turning both on. So the VoIP people can hear the people on the phone, and the phone people can hear the people on the VoIP, and everybody can hear you. And you have this plethora of choices for folks. If they want to join on the phone, they can. If they want to join just on computer speakers and a mic, maybe they're used to their headsets and speaking with their, you know, iPhone plugins. Great. You can offer these as additional solutions. Patricia, yes, a breakout is a really, really, really important part. If you do breakout sessions and you have people on VoIP and phone, it becomes a little bit more complex for you as the manager of breakout sessions, because VoIP people can join breakouts with other VoIP people, but they can't join breakouts with other phone people. So you have to be really conscious about like who's going in what breakout room. If you're having breakouts, it's really great to think about either choosing a solution that is, okay, look, I'm only going to have everybody join on the phone, and it's really important that we have that because it's going to make everything go much smoother for me. When I get more fancy and I get my sea legs and I can manage all the technical things and the delivery things at once, then we'll consider playing with having VoIP and phone options together, right? So for sure, all of those different things. Nelson, is there a way to mute user cell phones in Adobe Connect? There is. When you have integrated audio like we have at Meeting 1, you can actually mute everybody's phone lines, or you can mute individuals' phone lines even if they're on a cell. And so that helps prevent some of that like double secret mute thing that happens when people use their own mute button and not the mute button inside the program, which then causes, you know, additional audio disruptions and distractions. So one of my best practices that I suggest, Nelson, and for other folks who want to use phone components and have those kind of muting capabilities is that I set everybody up when I'm on a phone only or a phone and VoIP and ask them to use the mute button inside Adobe Connect on the attendee list to be able to mute their own phones. Or all the way up at top, you can actually mute your phone and turn there, because then I can see that you're on mute, and if you accidentally forget you're on mute, I can own and control the ability to unmute. We'll talk about that at the end here. Got a couple questions that I want to jump into in terms of some of these things. What bandwidth is your video set to? It's coming through really well. Well, thanks, Amy. I don't know. It's set up as the default bandwidth of, I actually have a fiber optic cable and a triple backup because I'm on video calls all day. So I'm hardwired in, and I have fiber optic, crazy bandwidth, very good. If I see any kind of low fidelity issues, I can turn my quality of video down. All right, so good, very good. Amy, we answered that on the session. Allison asks, what audio synchronizes best with live webcam, VoIP or phone? It depends on your bandwidth. When I'm looking at my second computer and I'm listening to myself talk, it looks like it's pretty synchronized. But if you have a slower connection, you might get a little bit of delay that's happening, and that really is about the bandwidth that's getting piped through your computer. So, again, huge consideration for trade-off if you're going to use VoIP only versus phone and VoIP. Okay, Shelby has a question. What are those breakout room audio restrictions again? Okay, I'll share with you the breakout room audio restrictions. If you do breakout rooms and you use this third option, which means enabling VoIP on over computer speakers and microphone and phone, meaning over the telephone, hardwire or cell phone, when you have breakouts in Adobe Connect, only the VoIP people who are on VoIP, can go to a VoIP breakout. And then people who are on the phone can go to phone-only breakouts. So you just have to segment your attendees out so that in the breakout, all the people on VoIP are in VoIP-only breakouts, and all the people on phone are on phone breakouts. Yeah, you're welcome. Or you can simplify it and clear the path and say, okay, you know what? I am doing breakouts, and I am just learning, and that seems too complex for me. I'm only going to ask my attendees to be on one. I'm only going to use phone so that I don't have to make sure that, these people are segmented over here and stuff. So it really is about clearing the path. Fantastic. All right, good. And Allison, it looks like I have answered the question of audio synchronizes best with live webcam. Very good. All right. So there's a lot of things in terms of considerations that you have with these three options. Let's jump in and talk about our next section here, and we're going to go really fast. So our next section, we've talked about simplest audio solution for your needs, for yourself and for your audience. Always go with what is the most simple for you to pull off and pull off well. Now, let's talk about multiple chat pods. Multiple chat pods are really great to be able to engage your audience even further over the cliff to an 11 by asking people to be able to share stuff in here. So we're going to do a sample of multiple chat pods all together. So I love that people have jumped in and are sharing types of sessions that you hold. There typically tends to be three different types of sessions that people do in live online. Either they're sharing information, or they're producing work together, like a working session or meeting, or they're doing relationship building, like kickoffs or introductions and these types of things. And, you know, it gets a little bit blurry because sometimes we do one, two, or maybe all three of these in our sessions. But what I want you to think about when you're completing this poll and this multiple chat activity is, what is the primary thing that you hold? So the kinds of sessions that you hold primarily. And so far we've got a lot of folks who have shared a little bit about some of these. I'm going to broadcast the results here. So about 91% of you are doing a lot of information sharing. 40% are using it, and about 46% are using it for relationship building. I love this. This is really interesting. Ah, Karen, you use it strictly for training. Yeah, absolutely. And maybe there is a little bit of information sharing and some activities that happen in terms of when you're utilizing this for training. So that's really interesting. Double, triple, quadruple thumbs up for folks who have said they're using this for relationship building, because that can be really critical when you've got a team or a group who is located at a distance or dispersed audiences. Okay, here we go. So I want to hear from you, the 89% of you who said you use information sharing. What kind of information do you share in your live online sessions? So give me some examples, information that you share. Thanks so much for multiple attendees typing in, continuing ed, training. Very good. Yeah, Nicholas, very good. You do new employee orientation at Denver Public Schools. That's a little bit of information sharing, and I bet some relationship building against new hires so that they can begin to meet people who they're working with. Fantastic. Michelle says upcoming programs and projects. Janet's giving a little bit of how-tos, how to get involved in programs. Medical ground rounds, oh, very interesting. So good information sharing, like here's what we got for the day. Maybe it's a daily stand-up. Love it. Okay, very good. So for folks who are doing work producing, what kind of work is being produced in your sessions? Share with us, what kind of work is being produced in your sessions? And then I actually am going to jump over here very quickly and jump into the third one, too, which is relationship building. So what kind of relationship building stuff are you doing? I know Nicholas said new employee orientation. Yes, I love it. Mentoring, very good. I love that relationship building ones. Work producing, yes, brainstorming, grant writing. Everybody needs to action item things, surveys, all of these things. Yeah, very good, very good, very good, very good. All right. Team building, software demos. Okay. So I'm really curious, and I am going to flip over, and I want to hear from you, because this is what you need to be thinking about when you're selecting the right audio for your needs, is I want you to think about, when you think about information sharing, work producing, and relationship building, I want you to think about the amount of time that the audience spends talking. So when you're in your information sharing meetings, for those of you who shared examples, what's the percentage of time that your audience is typically talking, right? They're the ones who are talking versus you. What's the percentage of time when there's work producing about the balance or percentage between the time that you're talking and the time that your audience or team members are talking? And then, of course, relationship building. So as you guys do this, I'm going to go ahead and broadcast these votes. Very good. Okay. So, you know, it's interesting, right? And this is typically the results that we get is, of course, in information sharing, there's a lot of time where the host or the person who, the subject matter expert or what have you, is doing most of the talking. You may want to think about simplifying your audio that you don't need to turn on anybody's phones and they can all be muted or listening over VoIP. For those types of things. Yeah, okay, a good spread in terms of work producing. So for folks who are doing work, you know, when it comes to any kind of work that's happening, for those who are at the less than 50% or 30% or less, you may want to think about multiple chat pods, right, that you'll want to use to be able to engage with your audience instead of having all of the audio on and waiting for the one-to-one type of talk. You might want to crowdsource the work that you're doing to get feedback all at once. All right, very good. I'm going to give Shelby the final say here, and I'm going to switch over to our agenda because we've got two more things to do and two more minutes to do it. So, all right, I'm just going to jump here and talk about the next section, which is silence is okay. So when we think about silence and working sessions, especially for those of you who are doing a lot of training, you may want to think about things that you can do in a session silently together. So just turning off and muting everybody and doing working sessions. We could have used a full hour here, totally. Amy, good feedback for next time. Next time we will jump in and do a full hour. I will stay for those of you who can and answer some of these question and answers up until the top of the hour. So silence is really okay, and it definitely depends on your objective. So when you're thinking about engagement and turning up that engagement, one way to do it is to think about things that people can do collectively together. So I'm going to briefly share this with you, and we're going to skip the two pods here at the top, but I want you to select this file here. We have a file to share with you, which is our audio options checklist, and this helps you think through what audio type or selection you might want to do. So in your next session, think about what it is that is your next session's purpose and the most important audio considerations that you have for this purpose, and then you can download this file and select all of the different considerations for each of those three different types of options so that you can get a sense of how you might simplify and clear the path. So I know that we're one over, and again, I am going to share this at the end, this download file here. I just want to talk a little bit more about the fourth best practice, which is all about owning the mute button. So when you own the mute button, that is a critical way of owning and taking control of the situation here. And that control of the situation allows you to proactively mute people and take and move them off of being able to be heard and not. So owning the mute button is critical. There are two things I just want to say about having a connected audio with your web platform is that you have the ability to mute everybody, and you have the ability to selectively mute or unmute when weird distractions happen and just prevent it from happening instead of asking your audience to kind of own that activity. So not only keep it simple, but whatever it is that you can do for them that clears a path for their experience is the most important thing when considering audio and your audio settings. So it is a lot, and it is very easy as you begin to learn how to do this by using some of the tools and capabilities that you have, because you can, once you know where to mute everyone, you can actually just click at the button, mute all attendees, and that will go ahead and mute there for you. So fantastic. We're right about an over 1 minute here on our 45 minutes, but I am going to stay an extra 15 minutes and answer these questions that we've got in the Q&A. If you can't stay, we're going to send out the recording so you can jump to the end of the recording and I can answer some of these questions. I know there's some good questions in the general chat that we'll get to as well. Brittany, if you could add those into the Q&A pod, any of the questions that came over here, I'll make sure that I answer them. And hey, before you leave, Live Online Learning Solutions has a special offer here for you. We're doing a service pilot beta. And for folks who are just starting, they're considering audio options, we are offering a beta test of our 30-minute needs assessment, and we'll provide you with custom recommendations for how you can take your engagement up from where you are now to beyond an 11 or over the cliff, the extra push over the cliff. If you're interested in that needs assessment pilot, there is a not anonymous poll right there, and if you want to sign up for that, as a beginner, as an intermediate, or as an advanced, we will be selecting some folks and inviting them to participate in our service pilot beta. So jump in and join with us. We would love to work with you if you're interested in working with us. It is that shared collaboration of continuous improvement as we journey into this collaboration web conferencing space. So thank you so much for today. Kim, I appreciate the feedback. Yes, I love it. Push over the cliff. Now I'm just going to go ahead and look through the Q&A, and I'm going to answer these auditorily. You are welcome to jump if you've got to go. You are welcome to stay if you want to stay. Don't worry. This will be recorded, and you'll get the link at the end. So thanks so much for the awesome feedback over there in the general chat. Any ways that we can share expertise with each other, I love it. So I'm going to start answering some of these questions in here. All right, so Shelby asks, and the VoIP-only setting is something you have to set up. So if you choose your audio selections, whether you want to make it really simple, you can choose to have VoIP-only, or you can choose to have phone only, or you can choose to have VoIP and phone. Usually, selecting those options, you can do it in two ways. You can either select it when you're setting up your classroom or your meeting room, and you can adjust those audio settings there in kind of the process that you use to set up the room, so beforehand, before even coming in. Or the second way to do that and select only the VoIP session only is to set up the room, come into it, and then adjust the audio settings. So all the way at the top when you're a host, there's a little audio drop-down, and that audio drop-down allows you to adjust your conference settings. So you can play with, like, okay, we're only going to do VoIP only today, or I'm only going to offer phone only. So that's where it gets set up. Perfect. Okay. Moving the right folks in the right grouping. Yeah, we talked about that in terms of breakout sessions. It just becomes a little bit more kind of breakout management as your host, or if you hire a producer or facilitator through Meeting One to help support you in some of those technical things, it just becomes a little bit more of breakout management when you've got folks who are on VoIP versus and the phone versus just everybody on the phone. Then you can easily use the, like, randomized breakout buttons, and it puts everybody into a series of breakouts. So it's moving the right folks in the right groupings, and it's all about host management. And it takes a little bit longer when you've got two different groups who are here. Audio equipment. Prima asks about audio equipment. Yeah, audio equipment, it's always really good as a host to have a good microphone. I use a landline, and I use my headset because I find that it is much better quality, and I can keep my typing fingers ready to participate with that multiple chat folks and multiple chat pods all at the same time. So it is important to have the right microphone. A noise reduction mic headsets are really helpful too. So if you're doing a lot of these, invest in good hardware, in good equipment. So I love the Plantronics one. You can go out on the web and just Google some of the best different audio headgear or hardware that will get you to what you need in terms of that. Prima had a question about relationship building. So yeah, great question, Prima. Relationship building, what is that, and what kind of activities are you doing in relationship building? So some of the folks said new employee orientation, where people are now meeting each other, and we're building some relationships with one another all together because we can't physically be in the same room. Prima, we also have relationship building activities where we do things like parties. So if you go on Meeting One's webinars and recorded webinars, we had a virtual holiday party at the end of 2015 where we got to play together and build some collective relationships together that just allows you to loosen up a little bit, and then also play together with your team, because that helps build trust and learning about one another. So there you go. So what kind of headset am I using? Prima asks. I use a Plantronics headset. It just says Plantronics, and so it's just connected to my to my landline. Prima asks another question. Why is there latency with my voice but no problem with the video? Yeah, great question. You know, that might have to do, again, with bandwidth that you've got going on, and I'm not sure if Prima is over the phone. Let me see if she's still on here. Prima is still on, and she's hearing this over VoIP, and so I'm not sure. That's a really great question to ask our experts with audio about latency of my voice that you're hearing with the webcam. My sense is that the webcam actually takes more audio or more bandwidth than the videos that I provided. When I upload videos, I make sure that they have that they are very low in file size, the lowest file size, so that they play the fastest. So that might be a great consideration when you're thinking about video files and playing video files over VoIP, if you can compress them to be the smallest file size that you have, then the playback will be a lot more connected with a zero latency because they come out the same way. All right, great. Other questions that we've got here. Elaine asks, when you have a group in a conference room, so only one computer, how do you suggest keeping interactivity going? Appoint a spokesperson, other suggestions? Do you need to think about room setup too, having many pods in this? Elaine, I love that you brought this question up, right? Like, a lot of people, when you're on big big webinars or trainings, they'll all gather. If they're in the same location, they'll all gather in a conference room and do it together. The best practice that I have for that, well, there are two. My first recommendation is that I say, okay, you know what? I'd actually like you to join from your I'd like you to join from your own computer and from your own desk. We're all going to be virtual attendees. So best practice is to say, like, no, don't join in a conference room together. Throw out your conference room table. Everybody join and level the playing field so that we're all joining independently and can collaborate and focus on what's going on in front of us. The second best option, because that doesn't always happen, is to ask every single person to bring in their own laptop and join the session. And then have one person call on the audio. So, you know, usually you have like the spider audio conference thing. You have one dial in there and then have everybody mute all of their computers. So don't join. You know, sometimes the good audio option for this consideration is to do phone only. And then everybody can participate on their own computers and hear what's going on the conference call. That tends to be a lot more useful than identifying a spokesperson, because what happens is that then they're off in their own conversations and we don't hear back from them, and we start to lose them, right? So that's my suggestion, Elaine, when you've got a bunch of people in the conference room. Ask them to bring their own computer and log in with their own name. All right, Dawn. As a voiceover specializing in e-learning training and narration, I'm curious about the reason some of you are doing new hire onboarding or other training via this method rather than traditional e-learning and the pros and cons. You know, Dawn, I would love to talk to you about this. I have a handful of clients who are doing this and can talk to you about what Adobe did for their new hire orientation. And, you know, it is really interesting when you've got a global dispersed employee set in order to be able to connect with them and connect with each other. So a really great way to be able to utilize this type of technology to do new hire orientation. So Elaine, if you're interested, we can talk a little bit more about that, and I'll give you some best practices of what I've seen about how this works versus traditional e-learning that is self-paced versus a collective experience. Elaine also asked, do you do these settings in Meeting One or Adobe Connect? Great question, Elaine. It depends on the setting. So when you have integrated audio with Meeting One, you actually can do them in either way. So you've got a backup redundancy option of managing these audio settings in Adobe Connect as you set these settings up, and then managing things like mute or audio in Click and Meet, which is an additional kind of window that I tend to have open that allows me to have even more control over the audio while I am hosting sessions. So it's a little bit of both. However, most of the things that you can do, you can just set it up in Adobe Connect if you've got that audio integration, because it's already connected. You assign the type of connection that you want, and then you're off and running. Okay, Amy asks, if you use dial-in or dial-out, you still have to merge the users if they do it themselves, right? Any tips for doing this simply? Oh, yes. I love that you can actually merge them in Adobe Connect. So what happens for folks who are not experienced with this is that sometimes when you use an audio, just the audio part, people dial in and that you get like call in user one, or you get their number, right? Like their phone number at the bottom, and then you get their name, and you've got to attach their phone number with their name. The best way to do this is to put some preventions in place at the front. So when you're inviting people to the meeting, ask them to ask them to join via having it call you back. So dial out. Using the dial out feature is a fantastic way to help have Adobe Connect that automatically versus having to go back and react to making sure that everybody is connected. Again, that becomes a big disaster when you've got like 100 people who you're dialing in. When you start to get over maybe 20 or so, you may want to think about adjusting your audio in different ways. Maybe you have them all join over VoIP and get that participation using multiple chat pods instead. That way you're not dealing or managing with folks who might not be experienced in connecting their phone with their name inside Adobe Connect. All right, it's 11 o'clock. I've got two more questions. I'm just going to go ahead and stay on and answer these additional two questions so that it's part of the recording, and then we'll wrap up and move on. Thanks so much for sticking around with us and answering some of these questions. You're welcome, Amy, and then we'll send out this recording along the way. George says, I understand the choice that attendees have to join by phone or VoIP, but how as host, are you connected to both? Yes. So when you use integrated audio, it connects them. And as the host, I tend to join on the phone because I need that high fidelity in a delivery like this. And so as a host, if you have both of those connected and you have your audio integrated in Adobe Connect, then you have the choice. You can join either by phone or by VoIP. And then Janet asks, can you let me know about the new hire orientation too? Yes, Janet, I absolutely will. So I'm going to reach out to both of you to make sure that we've got an invitation to talk about new hire orientation. It is pretty cool. Some of the big companies are utilizing live online experiences for new hire orientation. Maybe we'll do a webinar on it. All right. So thanks so much. We're going to pop open a survey for anybody who is still here with us and want to give us feedback on how we did and what we can do to improve on as we go. So I hope you have a great rest of the week and you can continue to consider additional ways that you can turn up your engagement to 11 or beyond. Thanks so much. Have a fantastic rest of your week. Take care.